So I have been using the POCO F3 since April last year, which as of the recording of this video is entering 9 months now, like a little baby in my stomach. And since we are already in year 2022, the question that I always get is, if the POCO F3 is worth it in 2022? So yes, in this video, I'll be giving you my long-term review about the POCO F3, about what I like, what I don't like, and of course, answering some of your complaints and issues that you have written in the comment section like this during my 1 month review of the POCO F3. Now, before I begin, just to let you all know that this review is based on the latest MIUI version 12.5.7 as of the making of this video, where the variant that I have is the 8GB of RAM and the storage is at 256GB of storage. And first, let's talk about my overall usage when using the phone from a build quality or the hardware's perspective. So ever since that little scratch, which I can barely even see right now, I'm happy to know that I did not have any scuffs or scratches during my further usage of the phone. Now, I still do think that apart from the Xiaomi 11 Lite 5G NE, this has to be my favorite thin and light form factor smartphone that I've ever used just recently as well. Now, while the phone comes with other colors like their latest Moonlight Silver, the Night Black and the Deep Ocean Blue, this Arctic White color is still one of my favorites compared to the others. Now, yes, I am a huge fan of white, if you know me well enough in this channel, but I am quite confident that you will love the matte pearl white finish, which does not attract any fingerprints at all. Now, speaking of colors, there's also a comment coming from a person named Q-Rex, who mentioned about the sides of the device losing color due to its pulling the phone in and out of his pocket, which I did not have any such issues. So sorry, bro, I'm not sure what your pocket is made of, but I did not have any such issues. Now, in terms of the physical buttons, both the volume rockers and also the power button are also very nice and clicky. Feels the same since I unboxed the phone for the very first time about 9 months ago, and it feels very nice in the hands until today. And speaking of the fingerprint sensor, it still works very quickly. Where if I had to say whether or not there's any difference in speed, I have to say that it is unlocking way faster than the first time I got it. So that was nice. Then there's a comment coming from Unroll Titung, who mentioned that he had lots of scratches on the screen because of its fingernail when he was gaming on COD Mobile. And then we had another follow-up comment coming from Phone Gamers, who asked whether his fingernails were knives. Be nice, buddy. But yeah, I feel that the stock screen protector should be removed, and even for me, I kind of removed it after the 3rd month of using the phone, and I did not have any screen protector ever since, and I also did not see any scratches up until now on the screen even after removing them. And also something that I would like to add is that I felt that the haptic feedback engine was surely one of the best in Android smartphones, especially within this price range. So now, let's dive in straight to once again one of the biggest complaints that I had about this particular phone, which is the display. So let's first revisit the whole screen dimming issues, because previously I had situations close to about 3 times when I was taking lots of videos and pictures for a really long time during a super hot bright daylight, like somewhere between 12 to 1 PM, and the screen did become dim. And personally, I think that that is totally fine and is totally understood, because it is a safety precaution to make sure that the phone doesn't overheat like crazy. Because this brings me to the fact that when I reviewed both the Xiaomi 11 Ultra and the OnePlus 9, where both phones overheated like crazy to the point where it was burning my fingers, and that was because of the Snapdragon 888 chipset, which a lot of people seems to prefer over the Exynos chipset, which I don't understand why until now. Now, what's also nice is the fact that the POCO F3 have been receiving updates over updates pretty frequently since the past 9 months of usage, and this whole screen dimming issue seems like it is a thing of the past, and I don't have any issues as of late. And then there's a comment coming from YouTube Psychiatrist, I love your username, man. Maybe I should book an appointment with you. Who mentions that if the screen is saturated enough, even though it's an AMOLED screen. Now, I would totally understand why he would ask such questions, because I have seen some AMOLED screen looking quite horrible, because not all AMOLED screens are created equal. But the screen on the POCO F3 is nicely saturated and is really bright with a high peak brightness of 1300 nits. And yes, the screen was as vibrant as how it was from 9 months ago. Then speaking of an AMOLED screen, Sebash asks if there's an always-on display mode and how does it look. Yes, there is, and there are plenty of themes and designs to choose from where you can get all your notifications over there as well. And another common comment, like from Neve Fam, was about if there's any AMOLED burns on the screen, which I've yet to come across any smartphones that have such issues for TVs, yes, especially for OLED TVs, but as of now, never when it comes to smartphones. And there's also another common comment coming from Domingo Gonzalez, whether if there's any green screen tint issue, which is something that I also did not have it at all. And no, there is no tint issues even on a grey background as well, as asked from Drew C. Next, as for video playback on Netflix, there was a comment coming from TDC who mentioned that if it's White Wine L3, and I'm not sure why that you have White Wine L3 instead of White Wine L1, because as clearly shown that the phone comes with White Wine L1 instead. So once again, you probably need to get your phone checked, or even the first time when I got the phone, it was always on White Wine L1. And yes, Satya Kishan, you can watch Amazon Prime Video on HD playback. So yes, overall I have to say that I really love the screen quality, especially when using it daily with the 120Hz refresh rate, where I did not find any issues at all from day one of receiving the phone up until right now. Next, as for the camera's performance, if you have been watching all of my comparison videos, you would know that the cameras on the POCO F3 is really good and holds up better than any other smartphones within the price range or even sometimes higher. While many came close to beating the POCO F3 when it comes to the rear lenses, both on video and pictures, but it did not come close to how great the skin tones and the dynamic range for the front video and the portrait photos and the regular selfie images as well. And during my last comparison video with the POCO F3 against the Realme GT Neo 2, one particular individual, which I don't plan to mention his name, accused me for not wiping the lens properly before taking the photos. Like, really, dude? Why would I sabotage the phone's performance? I mean, I'm doing these comparison videos and even this video for free, right? So, probably a very sad fanboy, but anyways, all the pictures on the phone look really great, as you guys can clearly see, especially when it comes to the video performance as well. And if you would like to see more sample videos or photos on the POCO F3, I'll link my entire playlist of the POCO F3, including the comparison videos that I've done, at the description below. Now, let's talk about using the phone from a day-to-day and how it is with the current MIUI update. Now, another very common question that people have asked me is similar to Johnny Hyperborean in the comment section, where they ask whether or not they should go with the 6GB variant compared to the 8GB variant to save some money. While the typical answer would be is that if you don't game a lot or multitask a lot, then you're fine, but I'm gonna say this. Just go with the 8GB variant for the sake of just future-proofing the device. Because who knows, some of the apps that you use right now may be fine by now, but maybe in the future it might require a higher RAM, so just to be safe. Because just like how I recommend people when it comes to buying a MacBook Pro or any laptop, try to go with a higher RAM instead, just for the sake of future-proofing the device. And just so you all know that all the video reviews and the comparison videos on the POCO F3 were based on me using this particular 8GB RAM variant, and I have no issues at all when using the phone every single day. Then Walid Shahryar, hopefully that's your correct pronunciation, asked if there's any other dark mode related issues, where I do get where you come from. Because some apps like Messenger, YouTube Studio, or even Shopee did not have proper dark mode integration, and now it integrates very well within the dark mode on the POCO F3. And another common issue is with the proximity sensor, where according to both Faraz Hassan and Souls, there were issues during phone calls, including voice messages from WhatsApp, where the display turns off by itself. And that is honestly something that I have no problems at all with. So probably get your phone checked, my friend. And yes, I don't have any other proximity issues, even during phone call too, Mr. Andy Chow. Then there's also many complaints about Wi-Fi too, where Breitman, nice name, mentions about having issues reconnecting to a Wi-Fi source after disconnecting. And also, there's no such issue. I can disconnect and connect my Wi-Fi and it goes back to the exact source without any issues. That's lots of issues in one sentences. Then Poshi Hirosha mentioned about how sustaining connection when used as a Wi-Fi hotspot is a problem. And I believe that this is a common problem from even some flagship smartphones too. Because based on my tests, about 90% of the time it was fine. Yeah, there were a few times where the connection does drop, but I don't think that that is a POCO F3 issue. But yeah, that is something which is indeed a common problem with smartphones in general. Then PJS asked about how the GPS signal was, and it was totally fine both on Google Maps and Waze, so no issues over there, and the call quality performance was also great too. Then there's this very interesting comment which I did not really understand, but allow me to try to answer it, yeah? It is from Means One, where he comments, "Adam, my phone is kinda yellowish lah. I try to chrome flags, but it does not work. Do you have any idea?" Demam kuning kot. Sorry bro, I don't know what you mean. Is it the screen is yellow or the phone is yellow? If it's demam kuning, then you need to put it in the sun more lah. But please don't put your phone in the sun for a very long time. And if you're watching, please allow me to understand what you mean by yellowish. Then when it comes to the phone's battery, with the latest update, I had a way better battery life on this 4520mAh smartphone, where from the beginning I was initially getting about 5 hours plus of screen on time, but as of late I've been getting pretty consistent battery life, close to 7 hours, so kudos to Xiaomi, or in this case POCO, for doing such an excellent job on the overall battery life with these software updates. Now, since the first day of using the POCO F3 for gaming, there was nothing but just positive things to say about this phone. And with the latest OS update, I've decided to revisit the whole gaming experience on Genshin Impact and also on PUBG Mobile as well. Now, as for settings on Genshin Impact, the best settings that I felt was the nicest experience was at medium settings, 60 frames per second with motion blur turned off. I mean, if you want to push it more, you can, because I did have some comments telling me about, oh, that's not the best way to set the settings for Genshin Impact. You do you, man. I'm just giving you my feedback, okay? Good? We good? We good? So based on the settings that I have mentioned, there was no micro lag or stutter issues, even with the medium graphics. And because of the great screen quality, I felt that the texture and the colors of the game was also really nice even at this medium graphic settings. And there was a very rare occasional ghost touch issue which happened maybe about 2 to 5% of the time. Now the reason why I would mention it is because it has happened, but also I don't think that that would be a huge issue, but it is worth mentioning as well. Now similar to before, the phone does get a bit warmer about 20 minutes into the game, but never too hot to the touch, even when I was playing games on the phone consistently about an hour or so. Then as for PUBG Mobile, the settings were at Ultra HD for the graphics and Ultra for the frame rate. And yes, the gameplay was still amazing because of the phone's screen. The touch responsiveness was also really nice, and the phone also became warm about 30 minutes into the gameplay, but once again, not too hot to the touch. And gaming on the phone on PUBG Mobile, even up to 1.5 hours, was totally great without any uncomfortable issues when using this phone when it comes to playing games on PUBG Mobile as well. So before we go into the conclusion of this review, allow me to tell you what I did not like about the phone, or I wish that the phone had. Now this might be a little nitpicking, but heck, there is no such thing as a perfect smartphone, right? Now, firstly, call me old school, but considering the price and the smartphone tier range, it would have been nice if the phone had a headphones jack, because personally, if you really want to enjoy that high-res audio that the phone mentions, that would be the best way when it comes to listening to high-res audio, which is through a headphones jack instead of a wireless connection. And the second thing that I would think would be extra sweet is to have an SD card slot expansion. Again, sounds very old school, but since I take lots of videos on the phone and I have lots of offline video downloads, where currently my workaround is to use an OTG thumb drive and plug it in and transfer all the videos on the file and then deleting it back from the phone. Yes, it is possible to live with that OTG thumb drive way, but it would be nice that if there is an SD card which can be living within the smartphone instead. Then finally, from a software's perspective, it would have been nice that if this 120Hz refresh rate is adaptive in order to save even better when it comes to the battery life. And another software thing that I think that is actually absolutely frustrating is how Xiaomi or POCO for this matter is totally tight-lipped about if there's gonna be a future Android upgrade on the phone, because that could be a deal breaker if you want consistent future Android OS updates. So now, as Aima Adlan and many of y'all asked me if this phone is still worth to buy right now in February 2022, I would say a huge yes. I mean, yeah, there is a possibility of the POCO F4 that might be coming out in a few months, but who knows for now. But with the current price of only 1,699 ringgit, as of the recording of this video, for the 8GB of RAM and 256GB of storage, I still don't think that you would get a better value smartphone like what the POCO F3 offers. But who cares what I think? What is more important is what you think. So tell me guys, would you get the POCO F3 right now in 2022 with all that have been said and of course mentioned in this video? Do let me know at the comment section below and do check out my two latest POCO F3 videos over here in case you haven't seen it. My name is Adam Lobo and I'll see you very soon.